so much for being here today. I'm very excited to be here to be sharing with you the work that I did during my PhD and on understanding the sex bias demography in canines. So to study sex bias processes, we compare the genetic diversity between the X chromosome and the autosome. And this is possible because in females, there are two X chromosomes, whereas in males, there's only one X chromosome. And so, according to your expectation, we would expect that the ratio in the population size between the X chromosomes and the autosome to be 3-4. And throughout this presentation, I will refer to this ratio as Q. And deviation of this ratio could indicate sex bias processes. So for example, when Q is less than 0.75, this could mean that there are fewer X chromosomes than is expected. And one possible scenario could be that there have been more male reproducing than females, indicative of male bias processes. And so conversely, when Q is greater than 0.75, there have been more X chromosomes than expected, and this could indicate female bias processes. So in humans, researchers have utilized this method, and we have learned a lot of interesting insights about the evolutionary process of human. So for example, in this paper by Phung in 2008, they surveyed a number of human populations, and they found that Q is greater than 0.75 in all these populations, indicative of female bias processes. Later on, in a paper by Keenan et al., they found that their resources are more consistent with a male bias process. Specifically, they suggest that the migration out of Africa has been male biased. And it turned out that these two papers use two different summary statistics to calculate Q. So Hammer et al. Used pi, which is pairwise nucleotide diversity across all populations, whereas Keenan et al. Used FST, which is fixation index. In a paper later on by Emery et al., they did a lot of simulations to understand what's the difference between Q pi and QFST. And they interestingly they found that while Q pi can detect the sex bias in ancient time scale, so that's prior to the split between two species, QFST can detect the sex bias in a more recent time scale, so after the two species have split. And so they were able to reconcile these two studies by showing that perhaps in earlier on in human history, the processes have been female biased, so consistent with practices such as polygyny, whereas leaving the split between different populations, so the migration out of Africa have been male biased. So as you can see, using the pattern between the X chromosome and the autosome have been really useful to giving us insights into our evolutionary history. So let's talk a little bit about dog. With the advance of next generation sequencing, people have been sequencing more and more non-model species, and dog have been increasingly become a model for studying evolutionary biology and also in medicine because they share the same environment with us, so it's a very attractive model to study medicine. And there's a lot of interesting questions about the evolutionary histories that we wanted to know, such as when and where the domestication happened, or even how many domestication events there were. And we learned that the demographic history has been really complex, that having included multiple population bottlenecks associated with the domestication event and also the breed formation event. There's also a mixture with wolves. And there's also evidence in the field that suggests that the mating practices could be sex biased. So for example, in the wild population, you typically think that they would have one in a wolf pack. There would be one alpha male and one alpha female. But then when one of them died, another wolf from another pack would migrate. migrate into the existing food plan, and that migration is usually male biased. And that's also evidence for multiple fertility. Whereas in the domesticated population, having papers that suggest that they're having more females involved is a great information as compared to males. And there's also this effect called the popular sire effect, where let's say that there's a dog with a really desirable trait, like for example, the greyhound can run really fast. So they would take one male and mate it to multiple females. And that would create a scenario where you have a lot of females contributing to the gene pool. So that could be female bias. And so even these are also patient in the sex bias mating practices, we wanted to use genetic data to test how widespread these mating practices are during different time points during canine evolutionary history. To do that, we used whole genome sequence data from 33 different female canines. So we focused on females because we wanted the genotyping between males and between the R chromosome and the X chromosome to be comparable, because it will create a lot of bias if we also use males. So these consist of five populations. We have the German Shepherd, Tibetan Mastiff, the breed dogs, and then in the wolf, we have the Arctic wolf and the gray wolf. So to ask whether any of the evolutionary histories have been sex biased in ancient time scale, we looked at Q-pi. So I'm showing here on the X chromosome, genetic diversity pi on the y-axis, stratified by different populations on the x-axis. And as expected, the genetic diversity pi is higher in wolf as compared to dog. We see the similar pattern on the autosomes. And when we take the ratio between the X chromosome and the autosomes, we found that all these ratios are less than 0.75. So how would that be? So if you pay attention earlier, you would think that, oh, this might be due to more male reproducing than females, could be indicative of sex bias processes. But there's also other non-sex bias explanation. The first is that natural selection have been affecting the X chromosome more so on the autosomes, so that could reduce diversity on the X. And another non-sex bias explanation could be due to a bottleneck event. So by a paper by Paul Newson, they showed that the bottleneck would have affected the X chromosome more than on the autosome, so that would lower diversity on the X. So to control for these non-sex bias processes, so first, for link selection, we employ an additional filtering criteria where we remove sites based on the genetic distance away from genes. So I use multiple thresholds going from 0.2 centimorgan to 1 centimorgan. And so here I'm showing Q-pi on the y-axis stratified by different filtering threshold. And this is for the German Shepherd. And as you can see here that only when I use the most stringent threshold, so 0.8 centimorgan and 1 centimorgan, will Q-pi approach 0.75. But then in the other populations, even when I use the most stringent threshold, Q-pi is less than 0.75. So we concluded that while this selection can explain for some of this effect, it doesn't explain for everything. So next we looked at whether a population bottleneck can explain this pattern. And the intuition for our approach is that if a bottleneck can explain this pattern, when we fit a demography parameters on the autosome, it should also fit the X chromosome if after some rescaling on the population size. So even the neutral expectation, if we rescale by 0.75, it should also fit the X chromosome. So specifically, this is why I did. I first infer demography parameters using the precise frequency spectrum on the autosome, using this model here that include ancestral population size going through a bottleneck and then expand to the current day population size. So first I test whether my inferred parameters can fit the empirical data. So I'm showing here the site frequency spectrum for the empirical data in gray, and then the blue bars represent the site frequency spectrum that I generated using the inferred parameters. So this that the info parameters fit the empirical data very well. So then next I rescale the population size on the X chromosome to be 3/4 that of the autosomes and calculate the likelihood. And then to test whether the AutoNet model is the best model, I search over a grid of these C values to see if there's any other values of C that could give a better likelihood. So I did this, approach for each population and for each threshold to remove the effect of link selection. So I'm showing here on the y-axis the info value of C stratified by different threshold, and this is for the German Shepherd. So this is really similar to what I observed before, where only when using the most stringent threshold of 0.181 will C approach 0.75. But in the other populations, C never approached 0.75. So we was able to conclude that the dog and the wolf demography history has been mostly mirror biased in ancient time scales. And so next we wanted to know whether that direction has maintained throughout history or it has changed. So to do that, we looked at QFST. So we looked at the within dogs population and the within wolf population. And for this, we found that QFST, interestingly, was greater than 0.75, suggesting that it has changed from male bias to female bias in dog. Whereas for the wolf population, it maintained to be less than 0.75. So that's the one method, and we also employed another separate method in order to study this. So we used an approach based on an approximate Bayesian computation framework in order to infer the C values. So just briefly, I infer the parameters using the summary statistic on the autosome, so pi and FST, using this split model here, and then I use the inferred parameters and rescale the population size on the ancestral population by a parameter called C ancient, and then the current population size called C recent. So here you can see that, so the yellow density plot showing the value of C ancient, and for the weeping dog is less than 0.75, consistent with our QPI analysis, whereas for the C recent, which is the purple density plot, is greater than 0.75, consistent with our QFST analysis. So in conclusion, we showed that the pattern in dogs and wolves have been male bias, consistent with what we observe about male bias migration and multiple paternity. We also see that the dog has changed to female bias, consistent with popular side effect. And if you're interested more about this, this has recently been published. And with that, I would like to thank all these nice people, specifically my PhD advisor, Kirk Miller, and my postdoc advisor, Melissa Wilson at ASU, and the funding sources. And thank you everyone for listening.
To think about the genotyping area.